Welcome, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
As awareness about coronavirus began to spread across the world, as the virus did, we heard at first what was happening in Pakistan, but not much since then.
We've since learned that healthcare workers went on strike following Pakistani authorities' failed response to healthcare worker needs. And Afghanistan is still dealing with the war. We're being joined by Ayesha Tanzeem, the Voice of America Bureau Chief for Pakistan and Afghanistan, to help us understand what's happening in the region. Ayesha, welcome and thank you for joining us. How are you doing today?
Thank you very much for having me. I'm doing wonderfully. I feel lucky that I have space to live out this corona period when we're all working from home. Just to clarify something at the outset, whatever I say here today are my thoughts and my thoughts alone, and they have nothing to do with VOA policy or the US government policy for that matter. So thank you for having me.
So give us a sense of what's happening in Pakistan right now and its response to the coronavirus pandemic.
So the first case in Pakistan was detected sometime in February. It wasn't very early, even though pilgrims from Iran were returning, possibly COVID-19 positive, but nobody was testing them at the time. So what's happened today is we've gone through a couple of weeks of lockdown, 6+ weeks at this time. It's different in different parts of the country because there are 4 provinces plus the capital territory. One province went on a lockdown earlier than the rest. But the lockdown wasn't fully implemented in the sense that while markets were closed, while shops were closed, fruits and vegetable markets, for example, were open, or banks were open. And some people were lining up outside the banks without masks, without social distancing. What's happened now is Pakistan's infection rate and death rate so far is still relatively low compared to what we've seen in some European countries and the United States. So for example, the death rate today, this afternoon, crossed 500. The infection rate crossed 2,000. It's a country of about 207 to 210 million people. So the prime minister has been saying again and again, we don't have it so bad, but we are not a well-to-do country. We cannot afford this lockdown because of the economy. You have to remember that a large portion or quite a large number of people in Pakistan are what people here call daily wagers, which is they go to work, they earn, they go back and feed their children. If they don't make money that day, it's very difficult for them to feed their families. So the government did give out some cash, about $100 per person to the poorest of the poor, but it only had so much money to give out. So yesterday, the prime minister announced that he was going to open the economy a little bit more. He had announced that he was going to open the construction industry first. And now yesterday he announced he's going to open a bit more of it. The government has issued guidelines. So for example, they've issued guidelines on wearing masks and using sanitizer and social distancing. But we have seen in some areas, so for example, in mosques, this is Ramadan, it's a holy month for Muslims. They fast for 30 days and usually attendance in mosques is high. While in a large portion of the Muslim world, mosques were closed for Ramadan, or at least they would offer the call to prayer through loudspeakers, but people would not be allowed to go in and pray in the mosque. In Pakistan, the clerics resisted it. They almost threatened to open the mosques if the government didn't come up with some plans. So the government kind of caved into pressure from the clerics and said, okay, fine, you can keep your mosques open. People can come in to pray as long as they're following these guidelines. And they gave 20 guidelines. Since then, the government has sent out people, officials to monitor. It's also formed a new force that they're calling the Tiger Force. It's a little controversial because the opposition parties think the word tiger is very close to the ruling party of the prime minister called the Pakistan Justice Party, or PTI as it's called. But anyway, this is a COVID force that the prime minister and his allies are saying are going to go out. These are volunteers who are going to be trained, and they're going to go out and they're going to make sure that people in mosques and stores outside, they're following social distancing rules and other rules. But once the industries open, once the shops open, once the markets open, for example, when people want to shop for Eid, which is the, one of the holiest festivals in the Muslim calendar, which is coming up fast, it's the day after Ramadan, so it'll be the end of May, around 25th, 26th, will people follow these rules? And if they don't, will there be a second wave of COVID-19 positive patients? All of these are questions. The opposition is raising them. The media is raising them. There's a lot of debate going on right now over whether opening up right now is a good idea, because Pakistan hasn't peaked yet. The infection rates are still going up. So we had, for the last couple of days, almost 1,000 new patients per day. So the infection rates are going up.
Ayesha, I want to ask you about a report that I saw about medical professionals going on hunger strike because of government's lack of response. Is that true?
Yes, it happened in various parts of the country, at least two to three cities where young doctors went on a strike, and they were complaining about a couple of things. First of all, they were saying they don't have the personal protective equipment required to deal with COVID patients. And they said, we're on the front line and we will get infected. There was one very moving press conference by doctors who were saying, we are begging you, they were literally talking to the nation and saying, we're begging you, if we start dying, who will treat COVID patients? Since then, we know that hundreds of doctors have been infected. In fact, there was a case yesterday of a doctor in Karachi, the biggest city in Pakistan, dying because he couldn't find a ventilator. And he was in an ambulance and his wife was calling various hospitals, and they couldn't find a hospital where a bed with a ventilator was open. And these are the kinds of things some of the critics of the prime minister's policies have pointed out to, that Pakistan's healthcare system is not ready to deal with a lot of COVID patients at the same time. It can deal with a few patients at a time, but not too many. And if the government opens up and the number of patients increase tremendously, the healthcare system will collapse. That's what the doctors have been very worried about that. They've said again and again, they did say at the beginning of Ramadan, they did oppose opening up the mosques. They did request the government to keep a strict lockdown, but the government, after looking at the economy, you have to remember Pakistan, even before coronavirus and this pandemic spread, Pakistan was on a ventilator itself. Its economy was on a ventilator. So the country is not doing well economically, and I think that's what the prime minister is worried about.
And what about Afghanistan? A report that I read talked about concern because of the ongoing war. What's happening there?
So Afghanistan, of course, is a country at war. And even without COVID, its healthcare system is really fragile. There are not enough hospitals. There are not enough quality hospitals. The few quality healthcare clinics or centers are set up by international NGOs, In big cities, you still find some, but in smaller cities, rural areas, there are hardly any healthcare facilities. There are some provinces where there's only one big hospital. So the country already has a healthcare crisis in many ways, and its population was not getting quality healthcare without COVID. Now with COVID at play, people are really worried that if it spreads, right now the number of cases in Afghanistan are only a couple of thousand, but almost everybody thinks the number is vastly underreported because they didn't even have testing kits. They got some from various countries, but there are very few testing kits. And they have a lot of people in prisons, a lot of population that is either illiterate or, you know, not very well aware of what's going on in the world. Even when the whole world was crying corona, people in, even in capital city Kabul, were going around without any social distancing or masks. Now the government in Kabul has locked down many things, but in other cities, in other provinces, in rural areas, many people are either unaware or they just don't have the facilities. They don't have the right kinds of masks. They don't have hand sanitizers, and they have very little healthcare facilities. So international community is extremely worried about what happens if this pandemic just start spreading rapidly in Afghanistan. And we have to remember, Afghanistan is right next to Iran. Of course, a lot of infections in both Afghanistan and Pakistan came from Iran, which got a lot large number of cases. So you know, these countries are already at risk. And with a war going on, it's even more difficult in Afghanistan.
Ayesha, we've learned that in some countries, the impact on COVID has been mixed. So in the United States, we've seen a lot of impact in poorer and ethnic communities. And in other places, such as South Africa, we understand that those who've been highly mobile and the international travelers have perhaps seen a higher incidence of COVID-19. What's been your experience in terms of where the pandemic seems to be hitting certain populations in both Afghanistan and Pakistan?
So it's very interesting. In this region, the virus seems to be hitting both the poor and the rich. So on one hand, you have these very dense populations of people, either lower middle class or poor people living in very congested dwellings or in very congested either slums, or even if they're better than slums, there are a lot of people living together. So social distancing is almost impossible. Plus, a lot of the people living like that are not the most literate, most aware people. So information gets to them more slowly, only when it becomes widely available on mainstream television channels. So they were late to adopt the social distancing and wash your hands and etc. A lot of them have now, because the government and a lot of even private corporations are running ad campaigns on television, making people aware. But then the other kinds of people who were getting this virus were people who had relatives returning from Europe or returning from US. So a lot of infections were coming from air travelers. And with even with air travelers, there are two kinds. There's the labor force that works mostly in the Middle Eastern countries. So I think a couple of days ago, a plane came from UAE, United Arab Emirates, that had more than 100 people positive with COVID-19. Now, some people who've returned from UK have tested positive, some who've returned from US have tested positive. So it's kind of diverse. It's for example, also in politicians, we had the governor of Sindh province who tested positive. We had some other senior officials who tested positive. So we can't say for certain that it's only spreading in a particular segment of society or in a class, whether it's an economic class or social class. It will, however, as is with most things in this region, impact the poor people more, because as always, in this region, the poor people have less resources. So in the beginning, for example, when the tests came out, they cost in local currency in Pakistan 6,000 to 8,000 rupees per test. That's very expensive for a poor person. And so I'm sure a lot of them who even had symptoms went without testing. Similarly with hospitals, there are private hospitals and there are public hospitals, and people who can afford private hospitals can often get better care. So while the government has set up, you know, COVID-19 testing centers, and they've set up, you know, mobile hospitals and other things around the country, it's very obvious in this region that people with resources and connections and most importantly money will get better care just because they can afford it. Also because they live in bigger houses. So if one person has it, they have space to isolate that one person in a room while the rest of the family can live in other rooms. In many of the poor neighborhoods, you have, you know, 5-6 people living in two rooms or more than 5-6 people. So there's no, especially in cities, there's not enough room to isolate if one person gets it. So the chances of the rest of the family getting it are higher.
So how are you staying healthy? I mean, are you still out in the street reporting, doing your job, or are you in lockdown?
I am in a mix. So I am working from home, as is everybody else in my bureau. We are essentially doing as much as we can from home. We are doing most of our interviews on Zoom or Skype, like we are doing right now. But then there are some things, especially when you're doing something for television, that does require you to go out. So we do understand there that there is a little bit of a risk in going out, but it's the nature of the job. If you're doing television, you can only do so much from your home, only so many interviews on Skype. You still need to go out and talk to regular people who cannot talk to you on Zoom or Skype, people who probably don't have a smartphone and people who are maybe suffering the most in mm-hmm. this crisis. So yes, we do go out, but we go out as infrequently as possible and avoid going out as much as possible. And when we do go out, we try to take as many precautions as possible.
With respect to what the future may look like in Pakistan and Afghanistan post-COVID-19, what discussions have been had, perhaps with policymakers, as to what these countries will have to do? And have there been particular things that have had a spotlight placed on it because of COVID-19 that may require more public policy and more public investment?
So the biggest thing will be the economy. So in both countries, Afghanistan relies heavily on foreign aid. It cannot meet its budgetary needs. It doesn't even generate, it generates maybe 25% or a little more than that of its revenue. The rest comes from foreign aid. With Pakistan also, as I told you before, it was on an IMF program to be able to keep the country from going into bankruptcy. It has so many loans, it has to do debt servicing and has other needs. So the biggest thing would be how to revive the economy. In both countries, they will rely on foreign either aid or donations or loans. But you know, there are other things that are going to go on and that are going on right now that have kind of taken a back burner because of COVID. So for example, Pakistan still has polio. The country has not eradicated. It's one of the maybe the last one or two countries in the world that still have polio. And because of this coronavirus linked lockdown, the polio campaigns couldn't take place on time. So that problem may start back up again. Again, a lot of people, unemployment, I read the figures somewhere and the government saying anywhere between 10 to 20 or even more million people may become unemployed. Now in a country that is already facing an economic meltdown almost, and a lot of people are daily wages and poor, a lot more people will drop below the poverty rate. So that problem will require serious thinking and policy planning, et cetera. In Afghanistan, again, if the COVID thing, if it starts circulating among the prison population, there are thousands, if not tens of thousands of prisoners that are packed like sardines in Afghan prisons. So it will be very difficult to stop that. There's a peace process that's supposed to be ongoing and that slowed down significantly for many reasons. This really kind of emphasizes how important it is to move that process forward. So both countries were almost in emergency mode before this real emergency happened. So for them, the problems have just multiplied, multifold.
So in the midst of all of this darkness that we hear about, have you found examples of when humanity shines? Like, what have you seen? What good acts of kindness and generosity have you seen?
So definitely I have seen a lot of people either donating food, there've been a lot of food donations, or donating money to various organizations, NGOs, etc., who are going out and donating food and daily essentials to people. Apart from the government giving out cash handouts, individuals are giving out cash handouts, and they're giving it out to, in most families, in both of these countries, they don't have a strong social security system like in the United States. So in these societies, your extended family or your extended tribe or your neighborhood or the people that you work with, they kind of become your social safety net. And I think that's what's happening. So a lot of people, I know, friends, co-workers, relatives, other people who've sent their maids and servants home, but they're still paying them. They've just said, go home. This is a difficult period. We will call you back when this time is over, but we will keep paying you. So people are doing that. People are giving extra money to make sure that nobody around them goes hungry, especially now because it's Ramadan and people usually give out a lot in Ramadan anyway. So usually what we see a lot in Ramadan is charity tables or charity feasts in almost every mosque, and sometimes on footpaths, and sometimes you'll be driving down and it's iftar time and people will be handing out food. What they're doing now is, because they're not allowed to do that for fear that people will gather, that they're giving out uncooked food. So you'll find people giving out boxes or which will have like rice and oil and wheat, you know, ground flour and all of those things, and they're giving those out. So people are doing that. The other thing that's happening, and I think that's happening all over the world, but that's become very, very clear, is the positive impact on environment because of all of this. So people are sharing pictures on social media of, for example, from their city, they can see distant mountains that they hadn't seen for like 20 years because of pollution. Beaches in Karachi that had become heavily polluted. People are sending pictures of how the water is cleaner than ever. The sand is returning to its natural colors. You know, wildlife seems to be enjoying itself more than it normally does. And, the sky is bluer. Even in capital Islamabad, I've not seen the sky this blue. So even though it's a crisis and an emergency, there's a silver lining. The environment is doing better. And some people are actually enjoying time with their kids or grandkids that they hadn't done in years because they were so busy working. So now they're forced to be in the same house with the kids all day long. And some people are coming out and saying, oh, we have a bond that we didn't have before. Mm. So yes, there are a lot of positive things that are happening in this dark times.
Ayesha, as we wrap here, is there something that you plan on doing after all of this has passed that you haven't been able to do or looking forward to doing?
Something special, yes, for yourself.
Well, for me, especially as a reporter, the most important thing is I'll be able to travel again. I mean, I feel like not being able to travel and not being able to go to places, I can only do half of my job, and it just tugs at me all the time. So I'm really looking forward to being able to get on a plane and go to another city, whether it's within Pakistan or in Afghanistan or maybe somewhere else. But yeah, I'm really looking forward to traveling again.
Well, Ayesha, thank you so much for joining us. Be safe, be well. And to our audience, just keep smiling.